Good morning, everyone. First of all, I would like to welcome today's speaker, Dr. Sridhar Sivasubbu. I also welcome our principal, sir, Dr. Jeevan Dontulwar, vice principal and IQAC coordinator, Dr. Reena Saha, Dr. Son Parote, head of the department, Dr. Gajbe, coordinator of Zoological Society, all other staff members, and dear students. Today, we are meeting to celebrate the National Science Day of this year. We have been organizing various events on the occasion of National Science Day, but due to this pandemic, we are restricted to organizing online lectures. But you can consider this as an opportunity that you can hear speakers from even outside Nagpur. And we have grabbed this opportunity to invite today's speaker. The theme for this year's Science Day is Future of Science, Technology and Innovation and Impacts on Education, Skills and Work. Now, by looking at this subject, you see that the topic is very fit for this year's theme. And therefore, we should consider ourselves fortunate to hear from such an eminent scientist. So, National Science Day is basically organized in our college for giving opportunity to the students to hear to various different aspects of science, which are usually something different from what they study in their syllabus. And this gives us opportunity to listen to many eminent speakers. So, I formally welcome today's speaker, Dr. Sridhar Sivasubbu, who is Senior Principal Scientist in CSIR Institute of Genomics and Integrative Biology. Before going to his bio sketch, I would like to request Dr. P.U. Gajbe to formally tell us about the Zoological Society. Over to you, sir.
Good afternoon. First of all, I would like to offer my best wishes to everyone on the occasion of National Science Day. A few words about the Zoological Society. Since the year 2010, we have been forming the Zoological Society of our college. And the first Zoological Society was inaugurated by Dr. C.B. Pawar, an eminent teacher and writer of zoology books. So since then, the Zoological Society has been functioning for the benefit of zoology students. Every year, we organized lectures by eminent teachers and scientists for increasing the knowledge of our students. And we also organize various events such as poster competition, essay competition, seminars and study tours for increasing the skills and knowledge level of our students. And all these things, they are beneficial to our students. So I hope that this year also, the students will help us and cooperate with us for organizing various events under the banner of the Zoological Society. So thank you, and over to Dr. Parande.
Thank you very much, sir. Now I would like to request Dr. Reena Saha to brief us about the activities conducted by the IQAC of our college. Over to you, madam.
Thank you, Nikhil. On behalf of my college department and as an IQAC coordinator, I welcome Dr. Sridhar, Dr. Dontulwar, our principal, Dr. Son Parote, our head of the department, Dr. Gajbe, in charge of Zoological Society, and everyone present online. National Science Day is celebrated not only to raise the awareness on the importance of science in daily life, but it is also our responsibility to honor the great man and his invention by contributing greatly to the field of science through innovation. We have been organizing different activities, not only related to the science, but we have tried to touch each and every aspect, though it may be curricular, it may be social, it may be extension of our subject, to the farmers, to the society, to each and every member of the society. And our principal, after joining last year, has been instrumental in infusing the energy to activate and participate to every level of to get maximum participation of every individual in the department, in of the college, whether it is a teaching or is a non-teaching member of the college. We have been looking forward many more such programs, and I'm very, very happy that Dr. Sridhar Srinivasu, Dr. Sridhar Shivasubbu will be speaking on a very important personal genomes to precision medicine. I am thankful and I appreciate highly to the efforts taken by Dr. Nikhil Palande for getting the MOU to such a very important national level laboratory and organization. I hope my students, my faculties will be very, very much benefited by his address, by his knowledge, and I am very much sure that his address will enlighten each and every member who is present or not present by the knowledge he is going to share. We will be recording. I hope we'll be recording all this event, and I'm thankful to, and I express my gratitude to our principal who has taken all the efforts for motivating all the departments, all the members and students to celebrate with the zeal and enthusiasm and this National Science Day. And this is having a very specific theme this year. And I hope the topic of today's and the next speaker will be helpful for enlightenment of this particular subject and the situation which is ongoing during this last year and this year of pandemic. I now stop here and I allow the next proceedings to go on. And I now request Dr. Palande to carry on the next proceedings.
Thank you very much, madam. Now, I would like to take this opportunity to inform you all about the achievements and the curriculum vitae of Dr. Sridhar Shivasubbu. Dr. Sridhar is currently working as senior principal scientist at CSIR Institute of Genomics and Integrative Biology, that is IGIP, which is a CSIR institute located at New Delhi, India. He is also working as associate professor, Faculty of Biological Sciences at Academy of Scientific and Innovative Research, New Delhi, India, and is also adjunct professor at Department of Medical Genetics, Kasturba Medical College, Manipal University, Manipal, India. When we look at his bio sketch, he has many achievements to his credit. He basically started with he completed his BSc in 1994, then MSc in 96, and he completed his PhD in 2001 from Manomaniam Sundaram University, Sundarnar University, which is situated at Tirunelveli, India. After completing his PhD, he joined as postdoctoral fellow to CCMB Hyderabad. Then he worked as postdoctoral associate at Department of Genetics, Cell Biology and Development, University of Minnesota, USA. Then after coming back to India in 2005, he joined as scientist fellow in CSIR IGIB. Then he worked as scientist, then chief scientific officer at the CSIR IGIB, which was a public-private partner company set up by CSIR IGIB. Then he became senior scientist, then principal scientist. Currently, he is working as senior principal scientist from 2016 till date, and he is also the head of business development at CSIR IGIB. When we look at his core scientific interest, he is interested in genetics, genomics, and precision medicine. One of the topics he has chosen to discuss and inform us about is precision medicine, which is one of his major research areas. He is working on personalized and precision medicine in human. He has also developed many models for application in precision medicine for humans. So he has developed zebrafish models to work on human diseases. He is also working on elucidating non-coding RNA mediated regulation of vascular and cardiovascular development and diseases. To his credit, he has many publications. To be precise, around more than 110 publications are there to his credit, which have been published in very reputed peer-reviewed journals. One more aspect I would like to tell you all about is his contribution to the technology commercialization. Everyone studies science, but to convert it into a technology and make use of it commercially is very, very important. In 2016, he and his lab mates have developed next-generation sequencing-based approach for diagnosis of mitochondrial disorders, and then it was marketed by the brand name MitoSure. In 2018, they have developed an application for molecular diagnostic assays for 27 genetic diseases, which is now licensed to Dr. Lal Path Lab Limited. And very important and interesting is, considering the today's situation, that in 2020, they have developed RT-PCR test for detection of SARS-CoV-2, which is now licensed and it is sold by the brand name COVIDSure Multiplex Real-Time RT-PCR Kit. So if I go on reading his bio data, it will consume entire time because his bio data is too interesting and very diverse. So without taking much of your time, I would like to request Dr. Sridhar Sivasubbu to begin his presentation on personal genomes to precision medicine. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Nikhil Palande, for the kind invitation and the elaborate introduction. Good afternoon to all the members present here, students, faculty members, principal, our external experts from the Zoological Society, as well as other organizations. I really thank all of you for this nice invitation and forum to share our recent developments in genomics. With that, let me share my screen so that we can start the presentation. Dr. Nikhil, is my screen visible?
Yes, sir, very much visible. The title can be read, Personal Genomes to Precision Medicine, Implications in Rare Genetic Diseases. Front page is visible.
Hello. Nikhil, can others hear me? Okay, I think I lost the connectivity for a short period. Anyway, thank you for the wonderful introduction. I'm going to go ahead with my talk and let me share my screen so that I can do that. Yes, Nikhil or Madam, can you just tell me if my screen is visible?
Yes, sir, you are also visible and your screen is also visible.
Fantastic, thank you. Okay, so for everybody here, today for the next 40 minutes, what I will do is I'll talk about a personal journey in many ways and also an institutional journey of how do you go from personal genomes, that is sequencing individual people, to converting it into an application that can be used in patients and in clinics. And how does it impact an area of genetics, which is known as rare genetic diseases. And so that's the journey that I'm going to talk about. In the picture, as you can see, is the image of CSIR IGIB, the Institute of Genomics and Integrative Biology, where I work. If you are going to come to Delhi or pass by Delhi, do let us know. We'll be happy to host you and show you around. Okay. It says CSIR lab, it's a national institute, so all of you are welcome. My research areas are largely divided into two parts. One is in genetics and developmental biology, where I like to understand how non-protein coding RNAs mediate vascular and cardiovascular development, where I use zebrafish as a model system. The second aspect that my lab is interested in is in personalized and precision medicine in humans, and that's what I'm going to be talking about for today. But before we go ahead, let us try to understand what is genetics and what is genomics, because genomics, people think it's a completely new field. That is not true. Okay, it is a subset of a field which is well established called genetics. Genetics is a study of specific individual genes and the role in inheritance, and that's what you see in the textbooks. Genomics is a very newer cousin that only came into existence about 20-25 years ago, which is the study of an entire organism's genetic makeup and its interactions with the environment or non-genetic factors, including lifestyle. So if you wanted to study genomics as a field, you need to have a very good fundamental understanding of genetics, and then genomics becomes easier. Okay. And having said that, the field of genomics, genetics, all of you have understood, no? The classical genetics in terms of Mendelian genetics, the Lamarckism the genetics, the various theories put out by the stalwarts in the field. These are all in the textbooks. Okay? But largely genomics begins, okay? Before I begin with genomics, it's going to understand the genetic composition of the individual. The genetic composition of the individual would be in individual cells, which are then encoded in the chromosomes. The chromosomes in turn are encoded by DNA, which all of you would have already known about if you have come to college and are interested in zoology. And this DNA in turn encodes for the RNA and the proteins. So to understand this composition of the genetic material is what the purpose of genomics is. And genomics largely begins, okay, as a milestone. If I were to look back into history, I would pinpoint this particular discovery or invention, okay, called as DNA sequencing by Sanger sequencing method by chain termination. Shown in your right is the picture of Frederick Sanger, who won a Nobel Prize in chemistry for this discovery or invention, where what had happened was you could take a piece of DNA, clone it into a vector, okay, into a small E. coli plasmid, into a plasmid, put it into E. coli and grow it on a culture plate. And now you can amplify it. Once you have isolated that plasmid back, you can sequence it using various modified nucleotides, oligonucleotides. Okay. Now, whenever this modification gets incorporated, the extension of the growing chain of the nucleotide stops, and these modified nucleotides also have a small fluorophore attached to it. That means you can shine a laser on them and get an excitation, and then you know what nucleotide was incorporated and be able to read it out. Okay. This, by and large, was the key milestone that allowed us to do genomics. And you can see the instrument at the bottom, which is called the automated Sanger sequencer, which is still very much in use in many labs around the world. Now, using this method and instrument, okay, you could sequence human genomes. For the first human genome that got sequenced is called the reference human genome, okay, and you can, as you can see on your right here, is a complete set of books in which the human genome is printed out. The four nucleotides have been printed out back to back chromosome wise. And that is how much information is contained in every cell of our body. Now, to read this information, one could do it in two ways. One, you could read these books from top to bottom in a very page by page manner. It is called SIG page by page sequencing strategy. Okay, very laborious, time consuming, but somebody has to do it. The another alternative is to take these books and completely shred them up or tear them up into small pieces, okay, line by line, and then let a computer assemble this jigsaw puzzle. Okay, when large powerful computers are able to assemble this jigsaw puzzle, you are able to re-get this whole book in a particular manner. So you could do it in both ways. In fact, this human genome sequencing exercise started in the year around 1989 and was spearheaded by 6 countries with a large amount of money, close to about $2.7 billion. And by 2003, they had completed one single human genome. And shown on your left in this picture is the sequencing machines. As you can see, you needed hundreds of sequencing machines to do this exercise. And by 2003, these two gentlemen here, Francis Collins and Craig Venter, along with the then US President Bill Clinton, made the announcement for the first completion of the first human genome. Now, what did they learn from it? That human genome consists of about 3.3 billion bases or nucleotides. They had spent a lot of money to do it, about $2.7 billion. And as a result of it, they arrived at the following key discoveries. One, that human genome contains more or less about 25,000 protein coding genes. And more importantly, they found out that 99.9% of the bases are identical between two people. That means the person you and the person sitting next to you are very, very identical. They only differ by a very small number of nucleotide bases. And this is very important because if you can figure out what is the difference, that difference could explain how, why you look different, why you behave different, why you respond different to diseases, why do you get certain diseases, or why does your hair look in a different color, why do you have certain genetic traits. So remember, so this small difference between people, okay, is the real crux that you need to understand. So by 2003, people had spent a large amount of money and countries were required to do this exercise. And that was not practically feasible to run it as a science. So you needed a technology shift to be able to do it in a cheaper, faster, and quicker manner by individual labs. And that technology shift came from this technology called as next generation sequencing technologies, or more specifically called reversible terminator chemistry. The way this works is that you can still take the small piece of DNA, in this case it will be 300 to 500 base pairs long, and put two address sequences. These address sequences means two pieces of DNA for which sequences you already know. The red and the blue are sequences that you know, and the gray is the sequence that you don't know. Okay. Now you can put this on a small glass slide as big as a specimen slide in your lab, the zoology lab. Okay. And these specimen slides already have the complementary sequences of the red and blue already printed on them. So when you can now do chemical reactions in which this red or the blue go and bind to these glass slides, and you can do something called the polymerase chain reaction. Polymerase chain reaction is amplification of one piece of DNA into thousands or millions of copies. Okay. And I hope you have read about polymerase chain reaction in your class. And this can be used to clonal amplify the fragments. Now, once you have clonal amplified it, you can supply the four nucleotides in various, combined with various fluorophores. And this is how the strand of DNA will look like. It will have the red sequences, it will have the blue one back there, and then the unknown ones in the middle. And as the fluorophores come and bind and a laser is shined on it, you can pick up images. So each of these dots in this image here, bottom panel, is a clonal cluster that you are imaging. And the color represents the nucleotide that has been bound to it. Now you can keep doing this again and again over a cyclic manner. And if you have you have very powerful computers that can look at a given clonal population on the X, Y, and Z axis. Therefore, you know which position that nucleotide is getting incorporated, what is getting incorporated, and what is the sequence of the incorporation. And you'll be able to use that to convert into a alphabet or the nucleotide compositions of that fragment. Now, a large number, about 200,000 to a million of them in this small plate, can be used to sequence one human genome. Okay, so we can do sample preparation, cluster growth, sequence them, acquire the image, and then do something called as base calling. While this might appear very simple on this cartoon here, okay, the kind of algorithms, computational requirements, the kind of technological innovations, and the chemistry that went into this is very, very innovative and complex, to the extent that some of the algorithms used in this are the same algorithms that are used to look at distant galaxies in space. Okay, if you look at this image, it does look like a distant galaxy in space. Okay, so you could use a similar algorithm to figure out what is there what does it encompass. Okay, so I'm going to ask all the students a simple question. There was one Indian involved in developing this chemistry. Okay, he was not in India, but he's a person of Indian origin who lives in UK that made this technology possible, called as reversible terminator chemistry. At the end of the talk, I'd like to see in the chat box somebody who can give me the name of this gentleman. Okay, that's a question for the students. Okay, so by 2010, remember I'm talking about 2003, the first reference genome got completed. By 2005, people could understand what it made. But by 2010, you saw a rapid decline. So this red bar is a rapid decline in the price of sequencing base pairs. You can see it went from 10,000 for a billion of base pair all the way to about a few dollars in US currency. Okay. At the same time, you can see from 2000 to 2010, the first reference genomes came on. The completion of the human genome was announced in 2004. And by 2007, the first individual personal genome started appearing in the world. So this was the time where people like me were beginning our labs. In 2006, 2007, we said, could we use this opportunity? And there was a second thing that was happening very nicely. Parallelly, that was, if you looked at the world population in the rectangle above is the various world populations and their admixtures shown, okay, and ask the question, which of these populations would have a genome represented? You had genomes out of Africa, from the Caucasian population, the Craig Venter and the James Watson genomes, and then you had the South Korean and the Japanese and the Chinese putting genomes, but bulk of human population is in South, Central, Middle East, and East Asia, and literally not represented by any genome. So that gave us an opportunity. Me and my colleague, Dr. Vinod Skadia, who is also scheduled to speak, I think, in a week from now, to undertake this mission of the first personal human genome in our country. So this sort of laid the foundations of what we know as personalized and precision medicine in our country. So what we did, we took a human genome, a population of that is not represented elsewhere in the world. This was an Austroasiatic individual coming out of the state of Jharkhand. And this population is not widely found elsewhere in the world. And we sequenced this person, tried to understand how do you make sense of human genome sequencing. Remember, the year was 2008. At that point, and there's a fantastic PhD student by the name of Ashok Patwari who spearheaded this and took it to completion. But we didn't stop there. We quickly realized that one human genome out of India made no sense. You actually needed a lot of human genomes to be done around our subcontinent. So we went ahead and did the first human genomes out of Sri Lanka, the first human genomes out of Malaysia. We participated in various activities around the Asian continent. And today, we can boast of three major large resources. One is called the South Asian Genomes and Exomes that encompass a large number of genomes and exomes from Southeast Asia. The second is the IndiGenomes. I will talk about this towards the second half of my talk, and your college And the city of Nagpur should be very, very proud to have contributed extensively to this program. I will talk about it, where we completed 1,000 human genomes. And then, of course, in the Middle East, we worked with our collaborators to create something called the Almina, which also looks at human genomes. Okay. So this is how you run collaborative activities. But finally, it is all about me. That means the small difference that you and me differ between each other, because 99.9% of the bases are identical between two people. That means there is a small difference, and we need to capture this difference and understand them. That's all. And that is the field of genomic medicine. It's a medical discipline that involves using genomic information about an individual as part of his or her comprehensive healthcare supervision. Okay, it's a very new field, and we are all still trying to understand this new field. Now, one of the major applications of this new field is in an area called rare genetic disorders. While the term rare is applicable to the rest of the world, given the kind of population that we have, I'll quickly convince you that rare is no more rare in India. Worldwide, there are about 7,000 to 8,000 rare diseases, and about 1,500 of them occur very frequently. So in India, this rare genetic disease accumulates a social impact, because 70 million people, that is 7 crore Indians, suffer from such diseases, and they undergo 8 physician visits, 3 misdiagnoses, and almost 7 years to finding the right diagnosis. Okay, and that is called something called the medical odyssey. So the idea is to somehow restrict this medical odyssey, have a general awareness, have affordable genetic testing, understand the mutation spectrum, and be able to put a system in place so that people don't waste 7 years. They can, a child with a genetic disease can be diagnosed in the first year of life. That's what is the whole idea that we came up with. And why India is a great place to study genetics? Because large population, close to 1 billion people, very diverse genetic pool. You can look at the person next to you, the person does not look like you, okay? Whereas in many countries, they have a very, very homogeneous population. In our country, we don't have a homogeneous population, but that's an advantage. We encompass representative populations from across the world because of the migration, wars, trade, good climatic conditions. So people like to come to our part of the world, so and so forth. But most importantly, population is stratified into small endogamous groups. That means we still maintain close-knit family structures, marry within the same community structures, have the same community fabric. Therefore, you can trace down genetic diseases very easily. Now, so what Dr. Vinod Skaria and myself did was to set up this program called Genomics for Understanding Rare Disease India Alliance Network. Again, we use all the advantages that is available in India, where patients, doctors could send patient samples that could be sequenced and mined. And if you found a mutation, a report is generated back to the clinician for counseling the patient. However, if you don't find what it does, or you have a new mutation, you can do experimental work on top of this. So today, Guardian represents about 280 collaborators from 70 major clinical or research centers, making this one of the largest rare disease genomics networks in India, and impacts over 5,000 families. It's not a clinical service, it's a research collaboration. So, but Guardian is not only about research. It's about research, education, diagnosis, policies, implementation, and learning how to work with people. So those who are interested in knowing more about it are welcome to read this fantastic review that we wrote last year, which encompasses all the 280 people and how we have managed to create this consortium. So largely we do three things in this consortium. Okay, one, if you have a person with a genetic disease and it's a known genetic disease, for example, the person comes with sickle cell anemia, there's only one gene that needs to be looked at. So we can do candidate gene approach. But in this particular approach, the cost is very cheap, the answer is very clear, it's only an yes or no answer, but you cannot identify a new gene. Let's assume there's a second gene that is involved causing the same disease in a very isolated set of individuals. You'll never be able to capture it. On the other hand, you could do whole genome sequencing, that is sequence all the 3.3 billion alphabets, but it's a cost intensive and computational intensive exercise, a lack of standardized tools. As an alternative, one could take a middle path, that is do whole exome sequencing. Exome covers only the protein coding component, which is about 1% of the genome and requires less data. Robust tools are available, and I'll give you examples how we have used whole exome and whole genome sequencing to understand the medical genomics world. Again, for students here, exomes represent 1% of the genomes. They usually code for proteins, and mutations in protein coding genes lead to about 85% of the genetic diseases. That means you can only look at 1% of the genome and be able to answer 85% of the genetic inherited genetic diseases. Therefore, it becomes a very attractive alternative option. Okay. Again, what are exomes? If you took a typical gene, you have a 5' UTR and a 3' untranslated region. These don't code for proteins. Okay, the large rectangles shown in blue codes for the exons, and the lines codes in between them, connecting them, codes for the introns. The exons all come together and they make the protein. Okay, and that if you assembled all these sequences together, it will make about 1% of the genome. So by looking at this small 1% of the genome, one can identify a large number of diseases. So that became a very attractive proposition. Now, how do you do this exercise? There are a number of, I already told you about the general chemistry, the reversible terminator chemistry. There are a couple of alternative chemistries available, like the single molecule sequencing, and more recently the pore-based sequencing. Those are all there, but by and large, the market is dominated. I would say about 95 to 98% of the market still uses the reversible terminator chemistry. And as you can see, these are represented by various commercial players, and one of the most successful ones is shown up here is a company called Illumina, which sells a number of instruments that can do this exercise very nicely and very robustly, and other market leaders. And I'll talk more about this NovaSeq 6000 or the HiSeq systems or the MiSeq systems. As you can see, they all represent different bandwidth or different throughputs that they can achieve. Of course, and shown in the bottom is the gold standard Sanger here, where you can sequence about 500 base pair of sequences and be 100% sure that you found what the sequence composition is. So you need a combination of something as robust as NovaSeq, where you can generate a terabyte of data every day, and a combination of a simple Sanger sequencer to solve this problem. Now, in a nutshell, how does this technology work? Is you can take genomic DNA, okay? You can shred it into a billion pieces, and now capture only the protein coding component using something called as capture probes, and put this down the sequencing machine called the NovaSeq 6000 or the MiSeq or the other sequences that are commercially available, generate data, and use extensive computational methods to assemble them so that now you can know that there is a mutation here. I'll show you more about this. Okay, once you get the sequences, you have to do a lot of computational exercises. You have to compare it with the right population, with the reference genomes. Now we have a lot of genomes available around the world. You need to identify the functionality. You need to have prior biological knowledge about the disease that you're looking in. You need to find linkages between how does the variation segregate or the mutation segregates in the family. And all this knowledge you can apply, we call as filtering exercises. These are all computational exercises to identifying a causal variation. So basically the 3.3 billion alphabets, you're looking at one alphabet that is misplaced. That's the whole trick. Okay, so it's a very exhaustive exercise, but nevertheless a very rewarding one. So I'm going to give you three case studies. One, how does this help a family? How does this technology help a community? And how does this technology help a medical discipline or a disease in general? Okay, so I'll start with the family one. Here's a family with congenital lamellar ichthyosis. Sorry. So Congenital amyloid ichthyosis is a skin disease as seen in the picture here, and about 1 in 2 lakh people are affected. This disease can be caused by mutations in 9 genes. Now, if we were to do Sanger sequencing for these 9 genes, it's a full 2 to 3 year exercise. Okay, as seen in this picture, the mother and the father have normal skin, and by this couple happens to come out of the state of Maharashtra and was referred to us by Dr. Ayush Gupta from Pune. They had normal skin, but the first two siblings actually had something called as a snake skin. That means the skin looked very much like a snake skin. Now, this is a pedigree. You need to draw a pedigree. This is the mother and the father and the mother and the two siblings. The two siblings are marked red because they have a genetic disease. Okay. Now, the trick is to find out what causes this skin disease. Okay. That. Now, by doing the exome sequencing, like I showed you two slides back, okay, we identified, did the computational exercise, sequenced their genomes, and we was able to find out that there was a mutation, or there was one nucleotide that was misplaced in a gene called transglutaminase 1, and we were able to identify it. Now, against the pedigree, the parents became pregnant, but before going ahead, we had to verify that this mutation was really true. So for that, you do something called a Sanger sequencing. Like I said, Sanger sequencing is the gold standard. Okay, so here is shown is the father. You can see, look at this one particular loci. Look at my pointer on my computer on the screen. You can see it's a heterozygous manner. There you can see two peaks, red and green. Same with the mother. Whereas the sibling one and sibling two, shown in red here, actually have a homozygous. That means there is no heterozygous signal. There is a pathogenic homozygous mutation marked with an asterisk. Therefore, that led to this skin condition. Okay. Now, we could use this knowledge when the mother became pregnant again. We could take a small sample from the mother's womb and test it for this mutation. And as you can see here, the child's Sanger sequencing at that same loci shows the same results as seen in the parents. So we could predict that the child would have a normal skin, and as it would have when the child was born, the skin looked perfectly normal. So this is the first. There are three stories here. One, you have a molecular diagnosis for this family, from an unknown disease to having a test available that they can undertake. Molecular diagnosis, it is called. Okay, so that's a very important criteria, because now it is not a disease caused due to a curse or a disease caused due to some sin that they did, nothing. It's a molecular test. That means there is a medical explanation, scientific explanation for why this disease is happening. It is in a gene called transglutaminase 1, which is responsible for formation of the skin. Now, second, okay, you could use this information to predict or prevent this disease in the next generation. Okay, that's a huge jump. Third, you could use this information to put this both the elder siblings on a retinoic acid therapy, and in about some time, a few months, okay, you can see their hair has grown back, the skin has started clearing out, their face has become almost, except for some freckles, they're cleaning off. You can look at the contrasting difference between a few months ago and this image. Okay, if they're fully clothed, very difficult to figure out that they actually have a genetic disease. That's how powerful you can, the genomics can be if applied in a proper way. Okay. Now, let me move on and talk about a community. So, in about 2015, we came across this newspaper clipping where poor parents wanted the mercy killing or euthanization for 6 of their 8 children, because they all suffered from a neurological disease, okay, which did not have any name, or people didn't know why it was being caused. And the parents have written to the president, so it came to our knowledge, and one of our talented students called Shamsuddin reached out to this family through an NGO and was able to, and they are located in Agra, very close to Delhi, and we were able to get the family's DNA. Now, here are the mother and the father, and the in red is shown the affected children and white is the non-affected children. Now, we did exome sequencing for the people with an whom you have an arrowhead. That means for 5 individuals we did the same exercise, did the whole exome sequencing and identified a mutation in a gene called MLC1. Okay, it causes a disease, genetic disease known as megacephalic leukoencephalopathy with subcortical cyst 1. Long name, but in short it's called MLC1. Okay, now again, lot of computational exercise. So this is not the only one family that we immediately noticed. We went ahead in the community and asked the question, and we found several more families having the same disease. So a single mutation causing a large number of individuals to have the same disease. So we quickly went ahead and did not do exome sequencing for all, because exome sequencing still costs 20,000 rupees per individual. So we did something called genotyping. That means we knew the exact nucleotide that is misplaced. So you can develop a simple Sanger sequencing based assay which costs only 500 rupees now and be able to administer to all the 82 members of the people around this family. And we could figure out that close to about 28% of individuals are carriers. That means they carry the mutation in one copy, and about 10% of the individuals are affected. That means they have it in the homozygous condition, or both the copies of the gene are affected, and rest of them are all normal. And this was done along with AIIMS New Delhi with the help of Dr. Shifali Gulati. So you could take a very expensive test in terms of genomics, convert it into an affordable diagnostics, which is now available for 500 rupees, actually available for free at IGIB. And if you go to a commercial player, they could be able to provide it with in about 500 to a few thousand rupees. So you could bring down the cost to affordable diagnosis. Okay. And the third is an area how genomics has impacted a medical discipline. In this case, is a story that I'm going to tell is led by Abhinav Jain and Vinod Skaria at IGIB. Where they look, along with the collaboration of Dr. Geeta Govindaraj from Government Medical College, Kozhikode, India. So here we look at a disease called as primary immunodeficiency disorders, or PIDs. It's a Mendelian disorder, okay, where the immune system is compromised to effectively eradicate disease-causing pathogens. That means even if they get a small infection, okay, that will linger on and on. It will not go away, and that will lead to multiple secondary things, and the patient finally has a very difficult prognosis. About 6 million people are affected globally with PID, and they are largely into three areas: immune deficiency, autoimmunity, and autoinflammation. A number of the graph shows the number of diseases represented by and a number of patients that we have. We have looked at about 297 patients coming out of the Government Medical College, Kozhikode, and using genome and exome sequencing, and 63% diagnostic yield was obtained. We could run evidence-based genetic tests in these families, build local capacity, we could build education and awareness. Now, what was the final outcome of this? Okay, in terms of clinical impact, that means the science knowledge that we generated could help in treating about 32 families. That means about 18 families could get intravenous immunoglobulin on a periodic basis. This government of Kerala started subsidizing for these patients because now they had a molecular therapy. A subset, about 14 patients, underwent stem cell transplantation. Therefore, they were able to completely eradicate the disease. About 7 families actually underwent prenatal screening, so the next generation is free of the disease. You can see how you can impact a whole area of medical discipline just by one single technological intervention. And now we have a clinic that runs at Government Medical College, Kozhikode in Kerala, where these families come and more people get treated, and Government of Kerala is happy to fund this along with other central organizations. So you could now provide a solution to these kind of patients who would have otherwise would have not made it beyond the first few years of life, now have a whole life to live for themselves. So that brings me to the next aspect of my talk. While we do all this clinical intervention, we also look at what is our basal composition of our genomes in India? So we run a program called Genomics for Public Health in India at CSIRIB. And this program, I'm very proud to say, was led by a person out of Nagpur who did his PhD from Nagpur University under Professor Arun Jadhav. And also, you all of you should be proud that Dr. Nikhil Falande from your own college was also involved in this study. And the study began at Nagpur. We started the study at Nagpur when in 2019, sometime in April, end of April. So this was looking at whole genome sequencing of 1,000 healthy Indians for healthcare and biomedical application. And we had to do this in 6 months. So Rahul Boyer, who was the person who led this, really did a fantastic job going through the length and breadth of this country, identifying the 1,029 people to develop the baseline genetic population. The idea was to develop India-centric, cost-effective, affordable and accessible genetic tests and work with the industry. So in this case, again, I'm saying it is this open collaboration of people willing to contribute to science really drives science. So people who are interested more in this work are welcome to read this nucleic acid research publication in which Rahul and Abhinav spearheaded it along with Arun Jadhav, Professor Arun Jadhav and Nikhil Falande are co-authors of this paper. So you can see how coming from even a very distant location in India, we are able to collaborate with each other in a very meaningful way. And I'm very thankful to the management, to Dr. Nikhil and Arun for extending the collaboration for the IndiGen program and all the volunteers out of Nagpur who made this possible. Of course, it would not have been made possible without the help of Rahul Boyer, who spearheaded this. Now, what did we find in this study? That Indians, we documented about 55 million single nucleotide variants, of which 18 million were very novel to India or Indian subcontinent. Therefore, this makes a case study why India needs its own basal genomes to be documented, because we look very different from Europeans. We look very different from the Far East people. So we are different genetic composition. So we need to have our own basal genomes to be documented. And that's what these genomes are available in this link at the bottom of the screen. And though in students who are interested to pursue research, please read this article at Nucleic Acid Research. It was published very recently. And this analysis was spearheaded by Abhinav Jain and another person very close to Nagpur at Wardha called Kavita. She is also a product out of the colleges of Nagpur. So you can see how many people in and around your own communities have contributed to getting this high-end science going. Okay, now what do you do when you have data like this? Is to do carrier screening, identify people. You can use it for pharmacogenomics, ancestry testing, HLA typing, incidental findings. You can keep on building all these tools that can be applied in clinics. And each of this is a PhD topic by itself. And it's beyond a PhD topic when you want to solve it. So therefore, generating this data actually gives us a lot of material for putting clinical applications. We also do a lot of education. We also work with put in fellowships for medical graduates. In this particular case, the CSIRIGB Sanofi Genzyme Fellowships for Medical Professions may not be applicable to your college, but this program called Genomic Variant Analysis and Clinical Interpretation, the 12-week course, which can be taken up by any life science or biotechnology undergraduate and postgraduate students, because this is the next major obstacle in genomics to able to clinically interpret the genetic variant. And this can only be done by human intervention. Okay, those of you who are interested in this course, the first round of course is just finishing. We will reopen this course maybe in a month's time, 2 months time again. You are welcome to come and join us. So what do you do at IJB when you have all this resource? Is to do population level work, convert it into genomics for rare diseases. Also, with the help of our partners, industry partners like Sanofi Genzyme, be able to convert it into high-end genetic test that is made affordable to the communities. It's available free of cost. Education and training is funded by Sanofi Genzyme. We also work with industry to convert that into affordable diagnosis so that it can be available in the rest of the country. And all this also feeds back into our research work. I'm going to stop there and acknowledge a large number of fantastic students around the country who have helped us do our science, our clinical collaborators, our basic science collaborators, such as your own college, the University of Nagpur, people like Professor Arun Jadhav, Dr. Nikhil Falande, who have all fantastically contributed to our genomics endeavors. Of course, all this would not be possible without the sustained funding from the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research over a decade and a half. Okay, of course, fantastic collaboration between IGIB from Vinod Skaria and others who have made this possible. And those who are interested to come to IGIB, the picture is in the background. You can see it's a very beautiful place to be in. So do please think about us if you want to pursue research. I'll stop there and take questions. Back to you, Nikhil.
Thank you very much, sir. First of all, I would like to thank you for considering us for collaboration. And we have been fortunate to have a collaboration and an MOU from our institution with your institution. And unfortunately, due to this pandemic, we were not able to come to your institution, send some students. But hopefully in the time to come, we are hoping that we can send some students to your institution and even some teachers if you allow us. And another thing is that you have mentioned about genomic variant analysis and clinical interpretation, which is a course which can be attended by UG and PG students. So I hope some of the students from our institution can take the advantage of this course and advance in the field of science. I would like to thank you for describing an important aspect or an important technology, which will be the future of science and technology in India. And I remember when it started from the first student that was selected from Nagpur University for personal genome analysis. And I was fortunate to be present there. And we have witnessed how this project has come to a conclusion and you are still progressing to the next milestone. So I would like to again thank you for giving us this important information regarding the cutting edge science technology that you have been using at your institution. At the end of this, I would like to request Dr. Sohan Parote, the head of the Department of Zoology, to propose a formal vote of thanks. Over to you, madam.
Thank you, Nikhil, sir.
Madam, just a second. Hello. Hello, madam. Badiye, madam, do we have some questions?
Okay.
Yes,
sir. There is some question from student. Very good afternoon, Shiva Subbu sir, and for the information you given today, it's very, very important, and we can say current status of genomics in India, and the work is very wonderful, sir. Some students is asking for more information about these courses. You have just shared about that.
Okay. So if you go to the, if you type Guardian and IGIB, GuardiaN, or I'll put the link on the chat box, okay, you will be able to find most of the information regarding the course. But I'm also sharing the link there so people can visit it, okay, and feel free to go through the website, and whenever you want to apply for a course or do something, you can just write to us on that email. And yes, I have shared the link. It's called guardian.meragenome.com. All the courses are announced on this website. And those students who are interested can just type Guardian plus IGIB on a Google chat, and you'll be able to figure it out. My suggestion is that if the professors can circulate this in the students, they are welcome to visit us, talk to us, write email to us, and we'll be able to happy to take it forward from there on. I'm also sharing my institute's email ID, website. So some information is also available on the website. So feel free to also look at the website once in a while. A lot of student positions are announced and we do actively recruit students on a monthly basis. So if you, anybody is interested, do write to us. You can write to me directly also, whenever you are interested. If you need a guidance for joining, my email, I have pasted on the chat box. So feel free to write to us and we'll be happy to help you.
Sir, you asked about the reversible terminator chemistry, Indian-born British chemist. So two of our students answered about this, Sanjeevni Vairagade and Chetna Amvadare.
Okay, what is the answer?
Sri Shankar Balasubramanian.
Yes, both of you are right. That's the right person. He contributed immensely to developing that chemistry that made it possible. I would like to congratulate both these students. And as a gesture, if these students want to undertake research, feel free to write to us. We would be happy to accommodate them, show them around IGIB and talk to them about what sort of research they are interested in, how we could help them. We'd be happy to do that counseling.
Thank you. Thank you much. Thank you so much, sir, for the information. There is no more question. Over to Sonparato, ma'am.
Ma'am? Madam,
thank you.
I have seen that Dr. Rahul Bhoyer is also attending a meeting. Unfortunately, Professor Jadhav could not participate, but I would like to thank both of these for giving me opportunity to get associated with the IGIB and Dr. Sridhar's
Nikhil.
Lab.
Nikhil,
yes.
I wish yes. to say that let us at least plan for the faculty a visit at the institute. Then we can even take the photographs and take a video shoot and inform our students if the students are unable to reach to that institute. Let us plan for faculty at least.
We will, if sir allows, we will go ahead and we will plan some meeting or visit whenever they have a spare time, and so that we can have more of the collaborative activity.
See, we already have active MOU between the college and the IGIB. So there is no limit restriction from our side. The only restriction would be the COVID-related travel restrictions that unfortunately we are in. So as soon as COVID ends, all of you are welcome to come. You can plan a trip. You can have a very focused training program if you want in genomics for the faculty first, and then extend it to as a tour to the students who want to come in. We would be happy to do that, but in the meantime, if there's online something that you need to be done, do let us know. We would be happy to engage the students and the faculty in an online forum.
Definitely, thank you very much for extending this invitation also, and hoping so this pandemic gets over very soon and can have some activity. Thank you very much. Now I would like to request Sonparuta Madam to just propose formal vote of thanks. Thank you.
Thank you, Nikhil sir. So good afternoon to the dignitaries, teachers, and student friends. On behalf of Zoology Department, I, Dr. Mrs. Uma Sonparuta, take up this opportunity to propose the vote of thanks. Firstly, I extend my sincere gratitude to Dr. Sridhar Sivasubbu for gracing the occasion and speaking on personal genomes to precision medicine, highlighting the importance of study of genomes in the understanding and treatment of many rare genetic diseases. We feel extremely happy to have entered a MOU with CSIR Institute of Genomics and Integrative Biology, New Delhi, and look forward to organize more activities as a part of this collaboration. I'm especially thankful to all the honorable members of Nagpur Shikshan Mandal for encouraging and providing facilities for the program. I thank Principal Dr. Jeevan Dontulwar for providing all necessary assistance in smooth organization of the event. I am extremely thankful to Vice Principal and IQVC Coordinator, Dr. Ina Saha. I thank the support staff of the department for their help. Dr. Nikhil.
We would like to take this opportunity to complete what Sonparuta Madam had started. We would like to thank the IQVC Coordinator for allowing us to organize a program under the banner of IQSC. We would like to also thank the coordinator of Zoological Society, Dr. Gajbe, Dr. Sonparote Madam, head of the department, all the staff of the Mohta Science College, and all the support staff who have helped us to organize this function in a successful manner. We would like to also thank Dr. Badie and Dr. Luharia for extending their help for organization. And at the end, I would like to thank all the students for participating in this program. And hopefully we will be able to organize more such programs where you can learn many new things other than your syllabus. So finally, I would like to thank all of you for joining this meeting and making this event a successful one. So thank you very much. And I declare that this event is over. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Nikhil, and thank you, the college, for the opportunity.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. We were really fortunate to hear you. Thank you.
Thank you. See you. Bye.
Yeah.